Please join us as we sing Holy Ground, and we have a new song, Jesus, All for Jesus. We're going to be introducing some new songs. We're going to try for two a month, one this month and two next month, and continuing forward. And we'll likely sing them 2 weeks in a row just to get them more familiar for people. And also, we're going to try something new. We've got the lead sheets, so there'll be a melody line plus the words on the screen for you. And we're going to try this for a month and to see how it works, if it helps some people to follow the melody line better, know when you wait and when you start to sing. And we'll try it for a month, and then if anybody has feedback, we're very open to hearing that. So join us as we sing Holy Ground.
Thank you. God has blessed us in so many ways. Let's bless God in return. Our heads together in prayer. Loving God, we give you thanks for this morning. We give you thanks that we can come here to worship you, to gather together over your word, to listen to some music, to sing some songs, to present ourselves before you with our gifts, to hear your message spoken, and simply to gather together, to talk to one another, to share our stories, to be heard, and to have the opportunity to listen and to care for one another. We give you thanks, God, that through so many witnesses that have gone before us, you set the example for the way we are to worship, for the way that we are to care for one another, for the way that we are to stand up for the truth in the face of injustice, and for the way that when we are patient, when we are open, when we allow you to enter our hearts, you transform us. You make us come truly alive. Because God, we know that you have given us the gift of life. We know that you are present everywhere and at all times. We know full well that you know everything. But somehow, we don't always act that way. We think that we can do it on our own. We often think that our success is the product of our own will and effort. We think that the things and sometimes even the people are around us are ours and ours alone, there for our service, and maybe even there because we chose to put them there. And so we exclude you. We leave you out of our lives. And we have to conscious to invite you back in. While we're doing that now, God, we are placing ourselves at your feet. We are inviting you in. We are asking that you take over for now, that as we worship and glorify you, you fill us with your Holy Spirit, with your wisdom, with your breath of life, that you help us to present ourselves before you in a way that is worthy of you, that you cleanse us and forgive us of our sins and errors, of the conscious mistakes that we made, and of the ways that we have gone wrong without knowing it. We pray that through the blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, we may be cleansed of these sins, and that by the power of the Holy Spirit, we may be not only strengthened to sin no more, but also encouraged and enabled to receive you more freely and more willingly. God, we know that sometimes we speak a prayer and sometimes we feel a prayer. So right now we'd like to simply present our silent prayers from the depths of our heart. Those words that we cannot offer, those thoughts that form but which have no speaking, which have no breath. Hear us as we offer you our concerns and cares in the privacy of our silence. Loving God, hear our prayers, for we pray in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Now I'm going to invite Ruth and Rhea to share our word. Does God just want to go to Sunday school? Thomas isn't quite ready. Is Rachel?
First reading this morning of God's word is taken from Exodus chapter 20, verses 2 to 7. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above, or on the earth beneath, or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the parents to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name. The second reading is taken from Galatians chapter 3, verses 26 to 29. So in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. For all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. If you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. The third reading, God's word, Galatians chapter 5, verses 5 and 6. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm, then, and do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. Mark my words. I, Paul, tell you that if you let yourselves be circumcised, Christ will be of no value to you at all. Again, I declare to every man who lets himself be circumcised that he is obligated to obey the whole law. You who are trying to be justified by the law have been alienated from Christ. You have fallen away from grace. For through the Spirit we eagerly await, by faith, the righteousness for which we hope. For in Christ Jesus neither circumcision nor uncircumcision has any value. The only thing that counts is faith expressing itself through love.
I'm going to deviate from the script just for a second. I don't know if you've noticed that there is a dearth of good English lately, that English is very poorly spoken, pronounced, written, and everything else. The words of Scripture are beautiful and well-written and wonderful English, but I also want to thank people like Ruth Ann who take the time not just to mumble through them, but to read them clearly and beautifully and to express them in a way that they come alive and that we can hear not just the beauty of Scripture itself, but also the beauty of the English language. So thank you, Ruth Ann. And Ruth Ann is also responsible for organizing the readers. So if you are interested in reading Scripture yourself, then please talk to Ruth Ann, and she will put you on the roster. So that's my sales pitch. We're going to sing.
Morning.
We're talking about change, talking about individuals that brought about great change. I want to just focus for a few minutes on the nature of change and the way it can come about. I think that there are two ways change can happen. First is spontaneous, and the second is gradual. The spontaneous change I want to illustrate by a gentleman you might never have heard of by the name of Philo T. Farnsworth. Well, unless you've talked to me, you might have heard of him, but you've probably never heard of Philo T. Farnsworth. How many of you have ever heard of RCA? You've heard of RCA? Big television company? Well, Philo T. Farnsworth is the unknown father of television. I have to rephrase that because modern televisions have changed. They're not the big, but you know the tube units that we all grew up with, right? With the big picture tube and the lines going. That was invented, that system, that electronic system of TV was invented as far back as between 1914 and 1916 by Philo T. Farnsworth when he was a teenager. He was only about 16 years old when he invented the electronic system that we call television. And it came to him in a field while he was plowing, virtually popped into his head, and in that moment there was a spontaneous and instantaneous invention. Nobody had thought of the things that he had thought of before. Nobody had imagined the way television could work. And one of the problems with these kind of inventions is he was so far ahead of his time. His ideas were so advanced that there was no technology with which to actually implement his invention. When he was old enough to start actually working on TV, he not only had thought of the system, he had to start inventing all of the tubes, all of the devices, all of the things to support his idea, which took money. So, even though it was a spontaneous invention, it happened all of a sudden, it took great money. It took a company called RCA and battles with that company. It took about 20 years before the first television came into practical use, practical invention. But it was an instantaneous change. All of a sudden, if he had had the money, he could have done it within about 5 years. We would have had television starting in maybe 1925 and broadcasts probably by about 28. Can you imagine that? How soon, how much the world would have changed? But Philo T. Farnsworth is virtually unknown today. His name is unrecognized. So we're going to put him in a department. While he was involved in spontaneous change, we're going to put him in a department called the famous unknowns. People that we should know and recognize, but don't. Now, on the other side, there's gradual change. Now, in the 80s, there was a revolution in computers, and we got the PC, and computers started entering the homes. But unlike television, where there was a single moment where we can say, Philo T. Farnsworth, on this day on the farm, invented TV as we know it. He didn't actually build one that day, but he invented. He came up with a system that revolutionized the world on that day, on that specific field. And if you talked to him, if he were still alive today, you could probably say how far along he was in the furrows plowing away. I mean, you could have just about identified the very second when it popped into his head and said, aha! Well, computers aren't like that. When we talk about computers, we talk about folks like Conrad Zuse and Alan Turing. You might have heard of Turing and other famous names, but there is no specific aha moment. There is no moment when somebody said, oh, that's how a computer can work, and suddenly drew it out and had the plans ready to go. Computers were a product of constant evolution, slow, gradual change, starting in the 30s, but it wasn't ever just one single aha, eureka moment where they came into existence. They just grew and grew and grew and expanded, and when they got into the market, then you saw great leaps because people got interested and there was marketing. But really, even all of those inventions, where we are today with the computers has been a steady, constant stream of invention, but no single aha moment that changed everything. And even in this system. How many of you have heard of Conrad Zuse? German inventor who developed one of the first all-digital computers in the 30s. How many of you have heard of Bletchley Park? Oh, okay. For a couple. Well, Bletchley Park was one of the places in England during the Second World War where they were working on breaking the German Enigma code, and there they developed a computer called the Colossus, which was one of the first computers that resembles modern computing. But, you know, there are these places throughout the world. Palo Alto, California, where a little company called Xerox, you heard of Xerox? Well, out in Palo Alto, California, they developed mice. You know the little mice that we all hate now? Well, they invented the mouse, but you know what? They thought it was so insignificant that it's not going anywhere. They neither patented, nor sold it, nor developed it. And it was a little company called Windows and Apple. Have you heard of them? That said, wow, we can do something with this. So there's all these gradual incremental changes that took place in computing. And no single person can be called the father of computing, the mother of computing. A bunch of famous unknowns there, too. Well, because we are talking about issues of church and the Reformation, we're going to go back to the period of the Reformation. And we spoke about Martin Luther. We spoke about John Calvin, and these are two figures that immediately pop to mind when you think of the Reformation. Probably the two most significant names, because with Martin Luther, there was a virtually instantaneous, a spontaneous change. Within a few months of him posting 95 theses, 95 discussion points, the world of religion started to change as a direct result of those discussion points. So there was a spontaneous change, and he is a famous person for it. John Calvin established, in effect, the rules, the thought process behind the Reformation, set it into place with his theses and his work. And again, his name comes to mind. His work was more gradual. It took years before he developed the final form of his writings. But here we have two figures who are well known and understood. But, as often happens, there were truths and changes before Martin Luther came on the scene with a gentleman named Huldrych Zwingli. How many of you have heard of Huldrych Zwingli other than Brian? Anybody? Nobody. Well, there he is. He was called a soldier for Christ. He was born around the same time as Martin Luther in the mid-1890s. But he predated Martin Luther's ideas by a couple of years. We'll explain why he might not be known in a few minutes, but Huldrych Zwingli was born just outside of Zurich, about 10 miles outside of Zurich. He was educated and became a priest. And as a priest, of course, he was a great fan of the church. And as a priest in the 16th century, he was rather poorly educated. He didn't know much about scripture, but he knew church law. He knew church law very well. But as he read, he did have a good education, so as he started to read, he encountered these ideas from other folks that had gone before him, that the Bible should be the primary source of all doctrine. Well, this got him thinking. This got him thinking about the church laws that he recognized, that he knew, that he loved. And it got him thinking about churches themselves. Now, this morning, Ruth Ann read from Exodus. The book of law, in fact, she read. And she read the passage that says, you will basically make no other graven images. You will have no other gods before me. You won't have any kind of thing, object, painting, statue, that you will worship. Now understand that this passage does not mean we cannot have pictures in the church. Because if we couldn't, then we would have to get rid of our stained glass windows. We would have to get rid of our picture of Zwingli. We would have to even get rid of things like our flowers and Jesus and his friends here, right? We'd have to dump this stuff. What that passage says is we cannot kneel before the statue and pray to the statue and say, oh, statue of Jesus, could you please help me today? I'm falling a little short in my behavior, and I need your strength. We cannot pray to the image in the window and say, image in the window, dove, could you please help me today? That's what that passage is about. The passage is about being distracted from God, from thinking that an object, oh, baptismal font, I'm feeling very, very dirty today. Could you please cleanse me? That's what the passage is talking about. Doesn't mean we can't have beautiful objects and say, baptismal font, you remind me of God's handiwork. Whoever made you is tremendously talented. Actually, we should be talking to the font, right? It should just remind us, you know, as we look at it, we come in and say, man, that is a beautiful piece of work, and that person really reflects God's talent. And isn't it amazing that in a piece of wood, we can find the beauty that God gave us? As opposed to, oh, piece of dead wood, could you come to life and do something helpful for me, please? So that's what those passages are about. And what Zwingli did was he realized that the churches were beautiful places, ornate in many cases. In many cases, the gilding and the artwork was so beautiful. And it was intended. Understand this. Those pieces of art were intended by the patrons and by the artist to express glory to God. The patron would throw tons of money in it to say, look, I'm giving my money, I'm giving out of my wealth to do something for God. And the artist would pour all of their talent in it to do something for God. But what ended up happening often was one of two things. Either folks in their more simple, primitive form of religion would start to worship the artworks themselves, the statues of Mary in particular. The veneration of Mary became this huge problem that was amplified by the fact that people would worship the statue. They would worship the icon, the hunk of marble or granite. And they would forget that it was Jesus alone that should intercede. They would forget this rule about no graven images. And Zwingli noticed that the religion was falling apart this way, that people were being distracted by the gilt and the ornaments and the statues and the paintings and all the lovely things. And in fact, not only were they going to the Virgin Mary and saying, oh, Virgin, please help me, or talking to the statue, but the places themselves, a second problem, was that the places themselves the churches, the statues, the contents were being, I don't want to say venerated, that's not quite the right word, but they were being put above God. They were becoming sources of pride. Oh, look at my beautiful church. Aren't I wonderful? You get that? So the patron says, look at my beautiful church. It's bigger than yours. Well, my church is smaller than yours, but we have more gold. My church is in between your two churches, but we have the best statues ever. You understand? Now, it wasn't even praying to a statue and at least hoping to have some God content in there. Now it was, this place is too small. It is not reflecting how generous I am at all. It is not showing the people what a magnificent man I am at all. I need a bigger church. Let's raise this one, and we'll have a little more money, and we'll build a bigger one. And that way, the whole town will know what a great guy I am. So that's where faith was. So Zwingli's reform came in two shapes. The first one was going to Scripture and saying, if it ain't in the Bible, it's not going to happen. If it's not written and recorded in Scripture, it is not going to be a guideline for us. Because church law and tradition had taken over. That's why the icons and the veneration of the Virgin Mary and the big churches were coming into play. That now it was tradition, and it was what people liked, or it was what the Pope liked, or it was what the priests and the cardinals liked. It was what they wanted, as opposed to what God said. So Zwingli came to this growing awareness as he studied Scripture, as he learned the original language, that you had to go to the Bible, and it was the sole source of all truth. Not what the church said, not what the Pope said. But of course, as he started to do this, he then started realizing things like the icons, the statues, had to go as well. So he began this reform. Now, the Switzerland of Zwingli's time, Europe, in fact, of Zwingli's time, was undergoing a great political upheaval. Folks were starting to realize, in places like Zurich, Zurich was made of, and continues to be, it consists of 13 cantons, what we would call provinces. So it had these 13 cantons, which were individual principalities, which were doing their own thing. They had their own economy, they had their own laws, they had their own rules, but they were Swiss. And what was happening was folks like Zwingli and others were starting to realize that a unified Switzerland, that a Switzerland that was following the same set of rules, that brought the 13 cantons and there were a couple of lordships and other small places. If they brought them together, and if they followed the same rules, and if they stood strong, not only would it be better for them, but also now Switzerland would be a good and better place. It would be stronger. It would be noted. It would have some power. Because here's the issue. Not only did we have the Holy Roman Church in charge, the so-called Catholic Church, but there was also this thing called the Holy Roman Empire. You heard of that? The church was politicized and militarized. It was not just a place about God. It was a nation unto itself. It was an empire that went from France and past Italy to Hungary and Austria, Switzerland, Germany, the north into Russia. So it was this huge power group. And what folks like Zwingli and other Swiss folks or Germans or French were saying was, you know what? This is ridiculous. This is ridiculous that we're under this Holy Roman Empire who's so far away, who only thinks of himself. And in fact, what was happening was the Roman Church was hiring Swiss mercenaries. Okay, so the Roman Church hiring Swiss mercenaries to go do its dirty work, to go do its invasions of other nations, its conversion, and its fundraising. You understand that so many of the raids and invasions and the wars started by the Holy Roman Church weren't faith building. They were to go to conquer lands and to increase its wealth. So Zwingli and other Swiss, other people from Switzerland, started to rail against this. They started to realize that the church was using their people for financial gain, and Switzerland was getting nothing other than dead young men coming back, right? So Zwingli had this sense of nationalism, but it was a sense of nationalism that said, you know, if we bring our churches together, if we start to reform our churches and to make it a truer church, if we start to get away from the Roman church and establish our own church and bring it together, then our nation will be stronger because we will be one nation following one way of practicing religion and not one nation following a religion that doesn't follow scripture and that is basically a militaristic political arm. So that was Zwingli's desire, part of Zwingli's change, part of Zwingli's desire to bring transformation and reform to the church. So from the church, there would be political reform as well. But it will be a political reform based on Christian values. Now, when you start to bring change against a major power, what happens? The major power starts to cooperate, doesn't it? Oh, sure, go ahead. Close down the Roman churches. Take the icons out. Let the priests marry. Do whatever you want. Go ahead, said the Pope. Oh, wait a minute, he didn't. That didn't happen. And the 13 cantons, these little provinces within Switzerland, all said, oh, Zwingli, what a great idea. Why don't we all drop the Catholic Church and become Zwinglians? No, it never happened. In fact, this was a militaristic period. As I mentioned, you know, there were these Swiss mercenaries, and Zwingli himself was a chaplain for the army. That was part of the expectation. The army had its chaplains. So Zwingli was a chaplain. And as the strength of the Reformed Church grew, it also gained political strength. So what happened was, a certain number of cantons, like Zurich, were starting to actually form this military arm. And at one point, they had five cantons that were resisting the Reformation. Five cantons that wanted to remain Catholic. And so the remaining cantons declared war on them. Now, it's all very well and good to declare war on somebody, but you have to be ready. You have to be ready for the consequences. And these five cantons were strategically located. Well, Zurich was strategically located. These five cantons had no access to food, to resources, to steel, to anything without going through Zurich. They were shut off from the rest of the world. Now, if somebody shuts you off from the rest of the world by declaring war, what do? You fight back? Well, virtually instantly, within a few weeks of Zurich declaring war on these cantons, they rebelled and they attacked Zurich. And Zurich was completely unprepared. One of those moments in history where you wonder what they were thinking, because Zurich, they had an army, but it wasn't quite ready. And so 8,000 men from these five cantons invaded Zurich, and Zurich was unprepared, and it was a massacre. And part of that massacre was Huldrych Zwingli. Because as chaplain, when the call to arms came, there he was. Now, he wasn't in the forefront of battle, he was a little bit behind, but when he was discovered, he became a victim. He became one of the 500 men killed in a battle that lasted about an hour. That gives you a sense of how unprepared Zurich was. But in that moment, Zwingli went from a major reformer in Zurich to a famous unknown, because his legacy stopped there. The reforms that he brought about, they started to be clawed back in certain areas. The churches went back to their old ways. The political powers went back to their old ways. It was in places like Basel and Geneva. Geneva in particular, where Calvin was establishing himself, that the reform really took place. But because Zwingli died at 42, before his reforms had a chance to really take place, he is recognized as a reformer, but historians are still wondering what exactly he accomplished. They know that his ideas paralleled those of Martin Luther, but were probably ahead by a couple of years. They know that he was, to a degree, influential in some of the longer changes, but there's no change. Remember, Zwingli Church, there was no church established like the Calvin, the Reformed Church, like the Lutheran Church. Lutherans down the front, that's a legacy there. But Zwingli is important because he did have some influence and some effect, and his ideas are ideas that stayed true throughout the Reformation. The idea of Scripture being the single central point. The idea that you didn't get to God through the Virgin Mary or through the altar, but went directly to Jesus. These ideas remained. So a couple of things that I want to share out of this. Ruth Ann read a passage where it said there is neither Jew nor Gentile. Paul, the letter writer, went out to his people and said, look, we've got to be together. We can't be fighting one another. We have to agree on certain terms. We have to come to terms with the fact that we are no longer what we were under the old way. We are something new in Jesus. And that was what the Reformation was like. We can't simply have these church laws in competition with God. We've got to establish laws. We've got to establish unity and agreement where we know that Jesus and God's word are primary. And we can't have the Pope interfering, or tradition interfering, or what my town does, or what your patron likes. If it's not in Scripture, we can't have that. We have to have that unity. Now, Paul does an interesting thing in this letter. Paul does an interesting thing because he says, we are Abraham's. Anybody remember Abraham? Abraham's kind of an important figure in the Bible because he's the first patriarch. This is the period in time when God is establishing his people. And Abraham is the first of these to whom God says, I will make a nation out of you. I will make a people out of you. I will establish you and your descendants as my chosen people. From Abraham, there was Isaac. From Isaac, there was Jacob. Now Jacob, also known as Israel, is the one who was the father of the 12 tribes of Israel, okay? So if you trace Abraham's lineage down through Jacob, you have the Jewish people, the Hebrews, right? God's chosen people. But Paul says, no, I'm going back two generations. I'm going back to Abraham. Why am I going back to Abraham, you wonder? Why did Paul go back two generations? Well, if he had stayed with Jacob, if he had stayed with Israel, if he had stayed with the Jews, where would we be? You understand? By going back two generations, Paul was saying it's not just about the Jewish people, because Abraham had two sons. Do you remember that? How many of you remember your old? There were two sons. There was Isaac, famously known for the one being almost sacrificed, famously known for being the one who had a son at 100 years old. But there was also Ishmael. Oh, wait a minute. There's another son. And God favored Ishmael as well. God said, you know what? You've been rejected by your father, by your mother, but I'm going to make a nation out of you anyway, because I promised your dad that I would make nations from you. So Ishmael goes off and forms nations. And the story expands. And you remember Isaac? No? Isaac had two sons, Jacob and Esau. And Esau lost his inheritance. He was the firstborn, so he should have had the inheritance. He lost his inheritance. And you know what God did? God said, because you lost your inheritance, but because I promised your grandfather Abraham that I would make him a father of nations, I'm going to make you, Esau, a father of nations as well. So you see, we've got the Ishmaelites, we've got the children of Esau, we've got all of these other folks, in addition to the Jewish people, and these are favored by God. That's us, okay? We are these other family lines. We are these other favored children. So Paul takes us back and says, this is a really broad circle. So it's not just Switzerland. It's not just Zwingli's Switzerland that's included, but Zwingli intended for all of Europe to be included, for the whole Holy Roman Empire to be included, for everyone to be included. Another thing, one final thing. In our passage, Paul says this. The only thing that counts is faith expressing itself through love. If we pare everything else down, doesn't matter if you're Jew or Gentile, doesn't matter where you come from, doesn't matter what you've accomplished, what matters is faith expressed through love. So if you believe in God, if you have faith in Jesus, if you trust the Holy Spirit, then you express it through love, through care for your neighbor, through supporting your community, through doing good things that reflect your stewardship, from inviting a friend to a roast beef dinner, from bringing your nephew for his birthday party to a church event that you love. Expressing your faith through love, that's what matters. And even somebody like Zwingli, you might well go away and forget completely about him. I don't mind if you do that. It's okay if you don't remember every single name or history that I detail. As long as you remember that folks like him might not be remembered, might not have a huge legacy, but they still made a difference in the times that they were in to the people around them. Because you know what? As you go out into the community, one person on this side of the church might not well remember every person on the opposite side, right? You might not know every name in this church. They might not know your name too. But you know what? Even being unknown, you can make a difference. Even just being part of faith expressed through love. You might go, remember there was a period a few months ago where folks were going through the drive-in at Tim Hortons and paying for the people behind them? How many of those people behind you think took down the license plate of the car in front of them and wrote them a thank you note? None. But they made a difference, right? Faith expressed through love. So there are going to be some famous people, some people that you remember well. I hope you remember at least Martin Luther and John Calvin as being important. And I hope you remember some of the members of your family, some of the friends you've made here in church, some of the people you're in with in the community. I hope you remember them by name. But I also hope you remember that those people that you have forgotten have made an impact as well. And just because your name might not be famous within the community, you certainly are known by God. And He appreciates the faith that you have expressed through love. Amen. Let's bow our heads together in prayer. Gracious and loving God, if we read the headlines, we get upset. Things are happening that we cannot explain, that we do not understand. We hear of violence within families, where 6 family members died at the hand of the grandfather, little children, and we shake our heads and wonder how that can happen. We hear of terror within the world, of organizations that purport to be faith-based, that purport to report to you somehow, and yet they are simply terrorists using every means at their disposal to scare people into submission. And if they cannot do that, they use violence, extreme and horrid violence. And we wonder how that can happen. But we know, God, that we cannot make huge changes by ourselves. We cannot make the world a better place, either through our wishful thinking or through our small actions. But we can make our corner a better place. And perhaps as we make our corner a better place, we can make our community a better place. We can inspire others with more influence and power, perhaps even with more fame, to make a bigger difference. So perhaps we cannot deal with the big problems by ourselves. But together, and even through our own individual efforts, we can help to bring about an expression of faith that is revealed in love. So God, we ask for your help within our own lives that we might be able to make a difference, to clothe the poor, to feed the hungry, to bring love where there is only hatred or fear, to bring healing where there is brokenness. We also pray for those larger organizations, for the agencies within the Presbyterian Church in Canada, for the larger agencies that work within our nation, within the world, the folks like the UN and UNICEF, organizations that are trying to make a positive difference. And we pray that you put the right people in place. We pray that we might be able to support those people, maybe even if you choose one of us, we'd be okay with that, God. But overall, we ask that as we express our faith in love, that you express your faith in us through your love for us, that you help us to know that we matter, that you let us feel your grace and your mercy. We pray these things in Jesus' name, and we say together, Amen. Please rise for our benediction. Now may the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, and the presence of Jesus Christ himself be with you this day and forevermore. And together we say, Amen. Amen.